Good morning, sir. Good morning, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
How are you, Jagat?
I'm good, sir. Thank you very much.
You're coming from Vellore or you are in Delhi for some time?
Sir, I'm in Delhi for the past 3 months.
Preparing for?
Yes, sir.
For the civil services?
Yes, sir.
Or any other agenda?
Sorry, sir.
Or any other agenda? Only for civil services?
Yes, sir. I'm preparing only for civil services.
See, in your prizes, medals and scholarships, you have given 100% attendance in your university 2010. Do you think it's a big achievement, 100% attendance? You have mentioned in your lab.
Yes, sir.
Do you think it's a big achievement? Everybody is supposed to attend the classes?
Yes, sir. I think it is a good achievement because the kind of curiosity that I have for learning new things when I entered the university and the kind of experience that I had with that, that made it more attractive for me. And that is why I consider it as a good achievement, sir.
So you get scholarship for that?
Yes, sir.
After 1 year of a full attendance or what?
Yes, sir. In my second year, I got it. First year, I had this attendance.
Because there are some views that you need not attend the classes every day. And even if you attend classes for a few days and do your studies privately, you could learn more.
Yes, sir. Sir, even in my university, the requirement is only 75%, sir, to attend, to qualify for the exams. But I did not consider myself to attend.
That's why I'm asking whether it's a, you take it as a big achievement.
Sir, I consider it as a good habit of mine.
Okay. You have been seeing documentaries on Indian tribes.
Yes, sir.
Tell me something about tribes, tribal populations. How many tribes we have, which are most primitive, all this thing, PVTG.
Yes, sir. Sir, with respect to the scheduled tribe population in our country, it is around 104 million, sir, 8.6% of our total population. Of that, we have 705 scheduled tribes, according to the Ministry of Tribal Affairs. Of that, of 705, we have 75 primitive vulnerable tribal groups spread across 18 states and one union territory in our country, sir.
Smallest tribe?
Sir, the smallest tribe is Andamanese, whose population is 40 in number.
40 or less?
Sir, according to the recent estimates, it's 40, okay, sir.
And there is another tribe in Andamans, very important.
Sir, Sentinelese tribe, who are most isolated compared to any other tribe in our country.
And the government is doing something for them, I think. In this month, they're going to inaugurate something for the tribal products. You know, have any idea about that?
I'm sorry, sir.
Have you heard of TriFed?
Yes, sir. Sir, TriFed is an organization which works for marketing the minor forest produce of the scheduled tribes and also promoting their traditional handicrafts.
Are they launching some new scheme? E-marketing they are launching.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Wipro. You worked in Wipro?
Yes, sir.
For how long?
So for 9 months.
Okay. Tell me something about Wipro. What's its position in the overall set of companies in India?
Yes, sir.
And in IT sector specifically?
Sir, Wipro started its business in refinery oil business in 1945. But today it is one of the major tech companies in our country, and it is in terms of its market share and its turnover, it is third in position in IT sector, sir, after TCS and Infosys.
Okay. Have you heard about tax and extortion in the Northeast?
I'm sorry, sir, I did not get it.
In the Northeast, there are so many insurgent groups.
Yes, sir.
And they are extorting money even from the officers. Have you heard about that?
Sir, I heard that extortion takes place, but I am not very sure about whether they extort officers or not.
Even chief secretary and DG police, they are paying money.
I am not aware of that, sir.
Okay. Kashmir, have you visited Kashmir?
Sir, I went to Vaishno Devi once.
That's not Srinagar.
No, sir.
What is SWOT? SWOT, S-W-O-T.
Sir, it is an analysis we do on strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats.
For whom we do?
Sir, we can do for a person or for an organization or for a country.
Have you done for yourself? online?
Sir, I have done for SWO, but I'm not aware of the threats that I am posed with.
So you're not aware of it?
Yes.
Sai, Jagat Sai. Wipro is known, especially the founder is known for philanthropy.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me about this?
Yes, sir. Sir, Azim Premji, the former chairman of the Wipro, he donated a lot for the social sector. Especially, he also came up with Wipro Foundation, Wipro Charitable Azim Premji Foundation. And other than that, for in the Giving Pledge initiative of started by Warren Buffett and Bill Gates, he was the first Indian to contribute to that initiative, wherein after his succession, some 35% of the share of his wealth goes to this foundation. And other than that, he also contributed to the education sector and improving the rural infrastructure in many of the states like Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and some other states.
Okay. You talked about the Giving Pledge. So in the Giving Pledge, our major billionaires or big industrialists did not pledge anything. Do you think we lack a culture of philanthropy in Indian society?
Sir, historically we have this tradition, sir, right from the ancient India, the munis and other big landlords, they used to contribute. But the generosity culture in India, that is in such a way that they do not show off, they do not disclose it outside, and they do it silently. And that is unique aspect with respect to India, sir. Today, the billionaires also contribute a lot. For example, Ratan Tata ji also contribute a lot to philanthropy. However, the number of billionaires that we can count are very few in number. And we have a huge scope for the other billionaires to contribute a lot.
So, we have heard about 3D printing.
Yes.
Have you heard about 4D printing?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me what is 4D printing?
Sir, the extra dimension in 4D printing from 3D printing is time. 4D printing is a process wherein we develop a three-dimensional product and we keep that product for certain amount of time under a set pressure and temperature conditions. And after that time, the product itself molds into different shape, the desired shape. And this is what 4D printing is all about, sir.
Can you tell me application of nanotechnology in mechanical engineering?
Yes, sir. Sir, in improving the efficiency of various systems, for example, the automobile systems itself, in the recent past, we have witnessed the evolution of nano engines, sir. So nanotechnology can also be introduced to bring efficiency in the automobiles with these kind of nano engines.
Oh, you talked about automobiles. Can you tell me latest developments in suspension technology and braking technology?
Sir, with respect to the braking technology, we have anti-braking, anti-lock braking system, which gives a steady posture for a vehicle and it do not allow it to skid. I'm not aware of the latest technologies in suspension systems, sir. I'm sorry.
You have an interest in tribal community and watching documentary on tribes.
Yes.
You're aware of tribal punchery?
Yes, sir.
Can you briefly tell me tribal punchery?
Yes, sir. Sir, our Honorable Prime Minister, former Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru ji gave this tribal panchil in the foreword to book written by Warrior Elvin in the philosophy of NIFA, Northeastern Frontier Agencies. Actually, this is an integrationist approach to give a policy to the Government of India going forward to deal with scheduled tribes. These include five principles. Firstly, the first principle is not to overwhelm the scheduled tribes with multiple schemes. And secondly, we need to hire and recruit more number of scheduled tribes to administer their own areas and not to include many outsiders. And the third principle is to protect and respect their land rights and forests. And fourthly, we should not judge the development of scheduled tribes based on the quantitative parameters, rather the quality of character that is developed among them.
Okay, so it's almost 70 years since
yes.
tribal punchery. How would you assess its contemporary relevance? What has changed since then? Or what new aspects has to be included in tribal policy?
Sir, there are a lot of changes with respect to the upliftment of scheduled tribes in our country. For example, the literacy rate has improved from 10% in 1947 to 59% in 2011. Having said that, there are many other areas where we can concentrate upon to uplift the tribes. The one major flaw that I see in our policy right from 1947 till now is that the one-size-fits-all approach that we adopt for the scheduled tribes across India. If we observe the deep social and economic parameters of scheduled tribes, they are very heterogeneous in nature, and we need to have customized approach for each and every scheduled tribe in every region and to address their problems. So this is what I would like to incorporate in the tribal policy, sir.
So you studied in Vellore?
Yes, sir.
VIT Vellore?
Yes, sir.
So you are familiar with Vellore?
Yes, sir.
Now tell me, describe Vellore.
Yes, sir. Sir, I consider Vellore as a very rich city which has a blend of both modernity and cultural richness. For example, we have the Vellore Fort, which is very historical in nature, and also in terms of the cultural richness, we have the Golden Temple in Vellore, sir. Other than that, there is also a very famous prison in Vellore, and the modern institutions such as Christian Medical College in Vellore and other institutions like my own university, VIT University, are symbols of the modernity that the city is going through. And secondly, sir, it is also one of the smart cities announced by the Government of India. There is a river which is underground in nature, the river Palar, that flows through, flows through the city of Vellore, sir. So this is, and it is one of the major contributors of Soldiers to
the
Indian.
What is the historical significance of Vellore Fort?
Yes, sir. Sir, in this very fort, the revolt Sipahi Mutiny of 1806 has happened. And it is, according to some historians, it is also considered as the first war of independence, because that was the first major revolt against the Britishers in the entire Indian subcontinent.
What are the factors that led to that mutiny?
Sir, just before this revolt, there was a kind of insult attributed to the sons and daughters of Tipu Sultan, whose children they were jailed in this fort. And the Sipahi mutinies were also asked to remove their beard and also remove their turbans. This incited them into revolting against the Britishers, sir.
So who could emerge victorious in that mutiny, and how that siege was lifted?
Sir, due to the military might and the coordination and superiority of British military, they suppressed the revolt within one day, sir. And later they have reorganized the system in which this fort is regulated and this area is regulated, and they took the entire area into their control.
Today marks one of the significant moment for India in global arena. Can you think why?
Sir, from today we are chairing the United Nations Security Council for the month of August, and that is a matter of
how that UN Security Council chair is rotated.
Sir, it is rotated on an alternate basis for every country. Sir, for every month. I'm not very clear about it, sir. I'm sorry.
Okay. Tomorrow, there is a country prime minister is going to launch another significant instrument. Can you think of what it is?
Sir, can I take some time? Sir, I'm sorry, sir. I'm unable to recall anything.
It is in fintech.
Okay, sir.
It is in fintech. I am giving a clue. E-Rupee is going to be launched tomorrow. Are you aware of E-Rupee?
Sir, the central bank digital currency. Sir, I am aware of central bank digital currency, but I haven't heard about E-Rupee, sir.
Okay. So, you were cricket captain in the university.
Yes, sir.
You participated in university, inter-university tournaments and all?
Yes, sir.
How did you your team fare?
Sir, I was captain for 9 months, sir, in my final year of graduation. We won one major tournament.
Which major tournament?
Sir, it was conducted in VIT itself. It is Rajaji National Inter-College Tournament, Cricket Tournament, conducted in 2014.
Mm-hmm. So, did your university participate South Zone Inter-University Tournament?
Sorry, sir?
South Zone Inter-University Tournament, did university team participate?
No, sir.
No?
No, sir.
Okay. Are you a batsman or bowler?
Sir, I'm an opening batsman, sir.
Opening batsman. Okay. What are all the advantages and disadvantages of opening batsman?
Sir, coming to the advantages, firstly, I will have, as an opening batsman, an opening batsman will have the maximum number of deliveries at his disposal to bat throughout the innings. And secondly, as an opening batsman, we will be able to assess the pitch and the kind of bowlers that the opposition have. And we can give a signal to the entire team so that the team can plan what is the optimum score that we can score if we are batting first. And coming to the disadvantages, sir, since we are the first to bat, there is a possibility that we might face the fiercest of the bowlers in the opposition and we may sometimes get...
How the role of opening batsman evolved from Test cricket to ODI to 2020?
Sir, in the Test cricket, the opening batsmen used to be very patient on the first day. They used to assess the pitch seam movement and also the bowler's ability to strike the decent line and lengths. Coming to the one-day international, sir, this has reduced a bit and batsmen started taking some kind of risk because they wanted to utilize the starting 10 overs of power play. When it comes to the T20, this risk-taking ability has increased manifold because the power play is only for 6 overs and opening batsmen are supposed to set a tone to the entire team.
Okay. Okay. You are presently working in Chengalpattu.
Yes, sir.
Hmm?
Sir, I worked in Chengalpattu, not now, sir.
Not now?
Not now, sir.
Resigned or what?
Yes, sir.
How long? How long you worked actually?
Sir, I worked for 9 months.
9 months. And after that, for this you resigned and started preparing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Which Chengalpattu, it is Mahindra City.
Yes, sir.
Totally how many units are there?
Sir, I am not aware of the total number of units. I am sorry, sir.
Okay,
I'm sorry, sir.
Anthropology has been your optional subject?
Yes, madam.
So, how does anthropology help us understand bureaucracy?
I'm sorry, ma'am.
How does anthropology help us understand bureaucracy?
Ma'am, in anthropology, we study the cultural relativism, which means that we understand every culture from their own perspective. And when it comes to bureaucracy, the working of bureaucracy on the ground level is also related to this aspect. We need to be very aware and sensitive about the kind of ground realities at every point of place. And secondly, the kind of hierarchy that we have in bureaucracy, that also needs to be respected when someone youngster like me enters into the bureaucracy and adapt to the new hierarchies. So this is how studying anthropology make us be aware and learn things very quickly and adapt very quickly, and that is how it helps us, ma'am.
You have worked with Diplo?
Yes, madam.
There was a question on philanthropy.
Yes,
how would you differentiate philanthropy from CSR, corporate social responsibility?
Madam, philanthropy is completely voluntary in nature, whereas CSR is legal according to the Section 135 of Companies Act 2013. And in philanthropy, there is no restriction on the areas where one wants to spend and also the amount that one has to spend. Whereas in CSR, it is mandatory to spend in specified sectors where government has enlisted in the act. And also, the amount should be around, I'm not aware of the exact number, ma'am, a certain percentage of the net profits in the past 3 years. So, this is how we can differentiate between both of them, madam.
But if it is not mandatory, see, before 13 it was not mandatory and there was no difference?
Sir, there is one more difference, sir. In philanthropy, it can be an individual work, whereas for CSR, it is for organization.
Okay. Some of the tribes that have been practicing polyandry in India, and the reason for that. Name of some of the tribes.
Madam, there are tribes in Lakshadweep and in also in Kerala. There are some tribes names are Melachery, Thakrufan in Lakshadweep. They practice polyandry, madam, because there are certain historical and cultural significance. These tribes are Islamic of origin, and secondly, during the British time, these male members of these tribes used to go for wars and also for sea expeditions, and they never used to come back. So because of that, as a matter of security, women used to have multiple husbands so that they would have someone to stay along with them.
Okay. Are you aware of Purushart concept? Is it relevant in modern times?
Yes, madam, it is very much relevant. The four concepts of Purushart: dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Dharma is very important these days because of the justice that we want to establish not only in India but also across the world, in the aspects like climate change and also in the international global affairs. And artha is also obviously important, ma'am, but it is predominating the other three aspects today. We need to moderate a bit to bring a balance. Ma'am, we need to have, with respect to the karma, it is also going unregulated in nature. The lust among the people, we have witnessing many crimes against women. And moksha, ma'am, it is a bit philosophical in nature, but yes, definitely it is also needed for the spiritual satisfaction of every human being.
Okay.